Well, g'day Dragons fans, and welcome to the Mad Dragons podcast brought to you by Complete Warehouse Solutions, a family-owned and operated business with more than 100 years of combined experience. Jeff and his team are more than pleased to assist in your Sydney warehouse refurbishment or fit-out project based on Commerce Drive in Lake Illawarra. Get in touch with the team on 4257 1930.
Just sit back there and you and take a little podcast brew. You gather around the night to drink, you give a point of view. Hazman is a panel spy, he shows that he has fun. And Donnie, our host, will jump along. God knows through the storm. God knows through the storm. Big T's our rock, he keeps his cool. He often gets his say. And just alive, he knows the girls and everything Dragons win. And everything Dragons win. The Mad Dragon Podcast is a journey unforeseen. With Hazman and Donnie Tudor. And there's Big T and Coco. Just the star, Muzzle and the other crew. Here on the Mad Dragon Podcast.
Well, it turns out firing up is a bit harder to do in the rain. The Knights really put out the flames as they simply played the conditions better than we did. The Dragons fans found out that with a few players in our team that you wouldn't back on a wet track. And for the third time in five games, we conceded 30-plus points. Alarm bells are ringing, but don't run for the exits just yet. And make sure you sit tight for Matt Hadler, who is going to dish out some wisdom in Heroes and Villains, but he's not actually on yet. So he's punctual as always. He usually jumps on about 3 seconds before we go live. But today he's failed to show up. He's just sent me a message. And he's going to be a few minutes. So we've got a pad with the rest of the team. Jeffy, he wasn't expecting that. He was looking down and, all of a sudden he's on the screen. How you going, Jets?
Yeah, pretty good, Donnie. Yourself?
Well, I've been better, mate. We've just been flogged once more. But All right, well, the padding time is over because Hazman has shown up. He's decided to grace us with his presence. So we'll get into this.
Well, what an absolute pile that was. Crap conditions, crap defense, crap forwards, crap leadership, and a crap referee. Where do you even begin to draw positives out of that shit? Lomax passed to set up Hunt's try. JDB making 42 tackles and only missing one. What about the fans who actually went to the game braving some of the worst conditions I've seen at a football game? Dragons fans especially, most of whom would have travelled some distance to watch that performance. I admire any Dragons fan that can turn up like that, especially given we can never be certain which Dragons team is going to turn up. So for that reason, got to give it to the fans this week just for making the trip. Speaking of crap forwards, I want to talk about one whose lack of performance has a lot of fans wondering how long his Dragons career is going to be. 9 runs for 61 metres is absolutely pathetic, as he's giving away ruck penalties because you're too slow and dropping balls with no pressure whatsoever. I am, of course, talking about Blake Lawrie. Back in the 80s, a big fat front rower was par for the course, and I reckon he would have done all right back then. The problem is, blocker, we're not in the 80s anymore, and you're too slow and ineffective for a front rower. Now, if Blocker's performance was bad, so too was referee Belinda Sharp, who, like most referees, has absolutely no fucking idea how far 10 metres is or how to referee a game evenly. Now, I know it sounds like the same old shit after a loss, but Belinda Shah's performance was like her initials, BS. Knights getting away with all sorts of shit in the ruck, holding down for what seemed like an eternity, while any such behavior from the Dragons was met with punishment. Didn't affect the result that much, but she needs to be better. So there you go, Donnie. The heroes are the Dragons fans, and the villains are Blake Lawrie and Belinda Sharp, or BL and BS. Back to you.
Yeah, well, I don't know whether you're going to get too much complaint there. It's definitely blocking, wearing a fair bit of criticism from fans at the moment. There might be a couple of other Dragons players that fans want to give a bit of stick to as well. Now we've got a few more of our panel members. We're still one short, but here is the panel that we've got with us tonight. Jesse, we've already introduced Rob, who you saw briefly. Hazman, you've already heard from, and Coco has jumped on as well. We do have some questions for Mother later on, so hopefully Mother's not too far away either. He's got an extra hour tonight, so with daylight savings finishing in New South Wales, he's up in Queensland, so. He's got an extra hour to get ready after he gets home from work. So hopefully he's not too far away and doesn't have the tech issues and getting on. I got caught the same way. With the change to daylight savings, I initially set this the stream up to start at 7:30. But all right, we'll get into normal segments. Mad Dragons Vodcast Player of the Year is up first. And for the fourth time, in five matches, the player voted by our panel as the man of the match is Zach Lomax. Rob, you had Lomax as our best. Talk us through what he did that impressed when so many others struggled.
Zach, for me, is showing pride and passion in the jersey, a never give up attitude. He just plays hard, plays tough, tries the whole game, the whole 80 minutes. He won't give up. No matter where you're putting, whether it's the wing, center, fullback, he gives it his all. And I believe he's been pretty much our best player this season. And hopefully rumors aren't going to be correct, sadly, that he goes. But he's showing to me that, I believe he's probably even better than Hunt, our best player this season. As simple as that. And I thought he was outstanding when he went back to fullback and safe. And I think he's been doing a magnificent job with all this talk about him leaving and obviously Flannery coming out and saying what Flannery's come out and said. He hasn't sort of packed it in and given up and all, given up on our team. So why can't the other players be like Lomax then? That's what I'd like to get. What I'd like to see.
Well, so, there's not a lot of pride in the jersey supposedly doesn't want to wear anymore.
Yeah, 100% yeah, has 100%. Been. Yeah, so...
But that's kind of the thing. They're like, people talk about wanting the players to show pride in the jersey. Zach Lomax doesn't want to play in the jersey anymore and he's been our best player. I mean, I think this whole idea of the players showing pride in the jersey is poppycock.
Yeah, but I think he's not giving...
None of the players have pride in the jersey anymore. None of them.
Yeah,
they play for a paycheck.
Yeah, but he's not giving up in games.
That should mean a lot to the players to wear the red V jersey.
But it doesn't, Jesse. It doesn't. They don't care about the red V jersey. I mean, it was great seeing Kyle Flanagan the other day when he scored that try and he jumps up and he points to the emblem. He's been playing for the Dragons for 5 minutes. He does not give a rat's ass about the club. He was kissing the Bulldogs emblem 3 months ago. It is for show. It is for show. The players don't really care about the jersey. We're the ones that care about the jersey.
He's not
giving
up.
But if they don't care about the jersey, then they can go away. They can feck off because we need
the Lomax. Lomax.
Then it's going to be you and me packing down in the front row, Coco.
Yep, I'm there. I'm ready.
We're the only ones that care.
I wear my heart on my sleeve. I want to see players that love playing for the. You remember when we won the comp? Dean Young kissed the red V jumper, kissed the Dragon. We don't have players like that anymore. We need
that's because all our juniors are going because none of the coaches want them, Jesse. That's what shits me with this fucking club. Sorry, guys, I'm swearing, but this is what I'm passionate, guys. These juniors, either from St. George or the Illawarra, are pushed aside for other fuckwits who don't even want to be in our team, and they get to go to another team. See, other people that are playing in Super League or like Tarek Sims, for instance, he had to fucking go to French Dragons, for God's sake. He was our great player. And, you know, I'm so sick of seeing our juniors going to other clubs and making it better when we have so-called good Illawarra juniors. Where are they all? They get pushed out when people don't even give a shit about our club. Sorry, everyone.
Like yesterday, I was listening to SEN in Wollongong, and they were mentioning, Free Dragons products that have been good for their clubs recently. Like Tristan Saylor, he's been amazing at fullback for Brisbane. Tyron Wishart at Melbourne, he looks good right off the bench at Melbourne, and he's doing a great job. Another Illawarra junior, and then son of the Steelers legend in Rod, and then you got Ruben Garrick over at Manly, another Gerringong boy too. He's really made a name in first grade, and it's really hard to see these Illawarra and South Coast products really doing well at rival clubs. It's really hard to watch.
That's a big part of it. That's a big part of it too. Like both of you have raised some really good points in that it's really hard for the players to show loyalty and passion towards the club when the club shows no loyalty or passion towards the players that actually love the club. And I don't want to have a crack at Hazman too much here, but I mean, Blake Lawrie is a perfect example. He's a guy that's a Dragons junior, bleeds red and white. He's one of the most passionate players we've got at the club. He's had a couple of bad games, and all of a sudden we want to kick him in the guts and kick him out of the team and send him off somewhere else and shop him around. Where's our loyalty to a player that actually loves the club? He's a guy that does love the club.
But that's part of the problem, because we haven't had coaches in the past that will drop players for poor form. They keep playing the same.
That's Wayne Bennett.
And that's what we
need. Hang on, Rob. Do we want players that love the club? We want players that will bleed for the jersey and love the red V, or do we want players that are good and are going to win? Because that's two completely different things. We're right now talking about one that loves the club. He would bleed for this club. He would do anything for the Dragons. We're talking about getting rid of him because he's had two bad games. The same with Tyrell Sloan. I mean, that's going to come up later as well. But we're talking about players that are Dragons juniors. They have a couple of bad games, and we as fans want to get rid of them because we don't care whether they love the club. We just want to fucking win, don't we?
We want a bit of both.
Get rid of the players. I'd say drop the players for poor form and not get rid of them.
I agree. You're not performing. Go to New South Wales Cup.
Yeah, I don't know. I think it's a tough one. At the end of the day, I think if we're winning games of rugby league, then we're not talking about any of this stuff. We're pretending that all these players love the jersey and love the club, and they're playing for the jersey. They're playing for money. They're professional rugby league players. If they got a better contract offer tomorrow, they'd leave. And that's okay. That's the world we live in now. We are the fans. We are the ones that love the club. We are the ones that show the passion. We need to continue to show it. But I don't think we can be expecting players to show the same level of passion for this jersey, for this club, as we do. They are professional athletes. That's the be-all and end-all for me. Anyway, we've got a little sidetracked, as we do tend to do on the Mad Dragons podcast, and moving into the second on the vote getter. So Zach Lomax, the player of the match. It really was a two-horse race this week, but someone has to run second. And this week with 11 votes, it's Luciano Leilua. Hazman, you had the Dragons edge forward as the better than the rest on the day. You actually gave him the 3 votes. So tell us why.
Because I just couldn't see anyone else that was worthy of it, to be perfectly honest with you. I mean, 14 runs for 167 metres, 31 tackles with only one missed. I mean, there's not too many players that equaled those stats. And we've looked, even though we've lost a couple of games while he's been there, we look at times a much better side when he is there. I mean, obviously shit conditions, I couldn't see anyone really, sort of standing out. I thought Hunt's kicking was bloody atrocious compared to what the Knights were dishing up. But, yeah, I initially had Leilua for three and two because I couldn't think of anyone else that was worth it.
Yeah. No, I'd already written the agenda when you finally sent me through a proper 3-2. So the next bit's actually not true. There wasn't actually a tie for third. It wasn't outright third, but initially before you sent through the update of 3-2-1s, there was a tie in the voting for third. I was surprised this bloke didn't get more votes, so I was actually glad that you did give him some votes there has been. So I might stay with you because Muzzle gave this guy the three, but he's not on. So I'll stick with you because you gave Big Frankie two votes. Tell us what you liked about his game.
Look, again, similar stats to Leroy. He had 18 runs for 174 metres and 38 tackles with one missed. I just think we're a better side when he is actually there, from time to time. And, as I said a minute ago, I didn't think anyone else was really sort of in the running.
Didn't Jacob Little tackle 53 tackles? Didn't Ravalava run for 213 metres?
Well, they're talking about dropping Ravalava. He was so poor in that game.
Well, he ran 213 metres.
He's not bloody dropping Ravalari. The only player that he's going to drop is going to be Blake Lawrie. It'll be Lawrie for Selle. I can't see any other changes coming.
And if Bird's injured too, I think.
Except the possibility of...
We'll talk a bit more about changes later. But, I certainly didn't think Ravalava had a good game. I know he ran a lot of metres, but what did he actually do that was good?
He didn't have an impact on the game, though.
I didn't think so. Larry Flicks just replied to my little rant before about Blake Lawrie that maybe so, but why keep a guy that'll bleed for the club? Lawrie would be last in every area of every aspect of every other front rower in the comp, speed, power, and mobility. I agree with you, and that is exactly my point. Like we get people saying that we want players that are going to bleed for the club, that love the club as much as we do. Blake Lawrie is that perfect example. I don't think he should be in the team. I think he should be back playing New South Wales Cup because he hasn't been good enough. He hasn't performed and he should be dropped. The fact that he's passionate about the club is completely irrelevant. We want guys to perform. And at the moment, Blake Lawrie's not cut.
I want a fucking paint house or an infernal Blake as
someone
a pro.
Will bend the line.
That's what I want. Yeah.
That's exactly right. Do you think those guys give a rat's ass about the St. George Illawarra Dragons, the logo, the red V, the history? Do you think they care, Rob?
I don't know. Give them two houses. Give them the keys to Wollongong.
No, but they don't actually care about the club. Like that's the point.
Don't really care about the club. They care more about their pay packet than about, So let's do that. Don't they do that at the Roosters? Doesn't the big boss of the Roosters hand out money left, right, and centre? Third-party deals or whatever? We're all cashed up. We've got all this money coming up. It only takes one player, one big player, and it'll be a massive help to us.
Yeah, so I don't necessarily agree.
Sorry, mate?
He doesn't necessarily have to be a big name. All he has to do is just do what a front row does and just take the ball up and go forward.
We need a big blocker, don't we?
Bend the line. It doesn't have to be a big name as long as he does his job and I don't care who it is, as long as he does his job, gets our sets rolling and puts us in good position.
How many years have we been saying this for now? We need a big bopper, big body, you know what I mean? Possibly can offload,
we've been looking for that guy, Rob. Like we brought in Josh Kerr to be that guy. Like he was huge. He's a massive guy. Stands about, 6'7". He's 120 kilos. He was supposed to be that guy. He was supposed to be that big bopper that would bend the line. He was a freaking pussycat. We brought in Eddie Blacker, who was about 6'12". He was 130 kilos. He lazy as fuck that ever pulled on a bloody jersey. He was hopeless. So we've been trying to find this big bopper that can bend the line. Now we've got Viliami Fifita, who is supposed to be that guy. Again, a huge human. He's played a couple of games. Is he that guy? Is he going to be that that player that actually shows some mongrel and can bend the line and can play that role. I don't think so. I think he's got similar issues to the other big players that we brought in. He doesn't seem to realise how big he is, and his work rate isn't good enough. And so, you know, we're talking at the moment about Nelson Asofa Solomona. Apparently he has no discipline, and he was told to lose weight, and he came back to training even heavier. So Craig Bellamy said, I've had enough of your bullshit. You can go down to reserve grade. He got put on report about six times in the reserve grade game today, so he's probably going to be out for the next 12 weeks because he's not a Melbourne Storm player anymore. He's an All Sydney Bear, and they don't get the same bloody latitude that the Melbourne Storm gets. So, again, is he really the guy that we want to be targeting? Is he the guy that we want to go after, a guy that's got no discipline and doesn't listen to the coach? So who do we get? Like, you want to get Payne Huss. We're not getting Payne Huss. We're not getting Nathan Fanua Blake. Who is it that you want to get? These players aren't available. The ones that you want don't exist.
Well,
what about Russell Packer and Leeson Armel?
Goes back to what I said before about recruitment.
Barbecue Man?
They says Anthony.
Having a Gus Poole, having a Shane Richardson, having someone like that. Apparently now Scott Fulton might be coming to join us with the recruiting. Fino can't do it all on his own with this club. As you just identified, Donnie, players don't want to come to us. So we're going to have to do something in the recruiting area somehow to be able to attract players. Because we get, I still think some of the new players we got are good players that have come in, but we seem to be getting players that are unwanted by other clubs.
I mean, Brady, makes a very
valid point here. Brady makes a Who's very that? Valid point. If the Storm don't want someone,
there's a reason.
Shouldn't that be ringing alarm bells?
Bellamy said the other day that he's still part of his plans going forward. He wants to work on him and get him into shape and get him to the player he wants to be. I mean, there will be time this year that Melbourne will need him. Yes, they will
depends on how long he gets suspended for all the bullshit he did in the game today. So he doesn't have a lot of discipline, and he's always been a bit of a thug.
There was an interview with Craig Bellamy about a week ago or so ago, and he did say that Nelson is still a part of his plans, and it's all BS talk about him. So I don't believe you. How many years has Nelson been there before, and how many good years has he played?
He's been there 10 years.
Yeah, he's been there a while.
So I think if anybody can put him on the straight and narrow, it'll be Craig Bellamy.
Yeah, if
well, Craig Bellamy's had him for those whole 10 years, and
put him back on the straight.
He's had enough of Craig Bellamy. I think he needs a new coach, needs a new voice. Maybe Shane Flanagan might be the man, but I don't know. He to me seems the only one that fits the mold of the player that Rob is looking for. That big guy that can bend the line. He's proven. Might actually be available.
But Craig Bellamy has ruled that out. He said he's still signed till 2027, and we want to keep him here until then.
Yeah. Well, again, if he gets suspended for the next 12 weeks and he doesn't lose that weight, then he just keeps getting fatter. We might get another George Rose from the Melbourne Storm. That worked out well for us.
Plays 10 minutes a game.
We're going to go front row that plays 10 minutes a game. His name's Blake Lawrie.
But that's not actually true. Blake Lawrie plays like 60 minutes a game. Like, he's got one of the best motors in our club.
He's only effective for about 10.
You realise he was our player of the year last year. He was the best player at the club last year. Like, he's had a couple of bad games, but yeah, I think people very, very quickly forget all the good that he did last year. He was, if not the best, he was certainly close to the Dragons' best in a bad year last year, and I hope that he can turn that form around.
He will.
Right, the other man that was tied for third, he actually wasn't tied for third, he finished outright fourth in the end. Thanks, Hazman. the always divisive Ben Hunt. Jesse, you had him for two votes. Hunt has come in for plenty of criticism after this game, but you still thought he was our second best player. Explain yourself.
Well, the two tries, the only two tries we got in the game, he had a hand in both of them. He laid that first try on for Lomax, that grubber to the corner, and Lomax was in the right place at the right time. Did well to put that down in the slippery conditions. And then he was there when Lomax threw that amazing flick pass inside, which allowed Hunt to go over and score. I mean, yes, his kicking game wasn't good, but I picked him based on his involvement in those two tries. And as a few of you have said, there wasn't really many standouts other than that. So just for that, I went with Ben Hunt.
At least Marie Cooper says no points for Hunt. I'm certainly in unison with LMC there.
Can we lighten up the mood here? Jesse, now you be honest. You're like a secret 007. You've got a template at home that has Hunt 3 points, 2 points, 1 point. And all you do is get your old-fashioned rubber out. And you rubber, you know, the 1 point, 2 point, or 3 point. You keep one of the, you know, the
points. Isn't it your boy, Rob? Isn't it your boy?
Oh, man, that's what you do. It's the truth.
He's your boy.
I don't know. He always does divide, I think, Dragons fans in terms of what they think of Ben Hunt. And I see where you're coming from, Jesse. He did a couple of good things. But generally speaking, the job of a halfback, I don't know that Hunt fulfilled that contract at all, particularly in those conditions. I don't think he managed the game. I don't think he controlled the game well enough to get points from me. He certainly had a couple of good moments.
Yeah, for the wet weather, his kicking game was atrocious, like, in that department. I will admit that, because you saw Cogger and Hastings kicking game. They were sitting up kicks in the in-goal grubbers, so they'd sit up in the puddles, and it would make Sloan and Lomax and Ravalawa hard to handle. And with the slippery ball and the ball sitting up in the water, that's what we had to do, take a leap out of Newcastle's book. But we tried the bombs, and we tried to play a dry weather game in torrential rain, and we just didn't play to the conditions.
But was it the same story? Flano Jr. never kicked the ball. Bomani never kicked the ball. Sullivan never kicked the ball.
Hunt the one time he got the kick on what the one time he got the ball on the last tackle, he died with it.
Yeah.
No, I did see another time where he got the ball on the last tackle. He panicked, looking around for Ben Hunt. Where the hell's Ben Hunt? And then he just threw a pass to Ben Hunt to let him kick. And there was another time where I don't think it was Jacob Little at dummy half. I think somebody else went at the dummy half. They looked to their left, saw Kyle Flanagan, went to pass it to him, and he's gone, no, pass it over to Hunt. I don't want it on the last.
Yeah, he has no confidence in himself at all.
Well, that's a big problem. Well,
that's not good. Is that
him not having confidence in himself, or is that a directive that Hunt does all the kicking?
I think it's a directive. It has to be. It has to be what the coach wants.
You wouldn't think the coach that wants his son to have a role in the kicking to take some pressure off Hunt.
No,
I mean, Flano was all for having Kyle at six to take pressure off Hunt. And not once did he have a kick the other night. And I agree with you. You said it a few months ago, Donnie, that he doesn't look like he's an NRL half. And well, I can see why.
That's the whole fucking reason that he's playing six now.
I can see the reason why he's been let go by three clubs.
What was that, Hazman? Oh, sorry, I missed that. Jesse was talking still.
Yeah, sorry. Look, the whole reason that Flanagan's there is to take some of the bloody pressure off Hunt. You know, the coach has bloody said that. Well, where the fuck is it?
Yeah, and it seems we have this conversation.
There's zero evidence that's happening. So I don't think it's a directive from the coach. I think it's a bloody directive from Hunt, and Kyle just can't find it in himself to tell Hunt go fuck himself.
I just think Hunt has an ego problem and won't let the young guy have a chance. That's what I think.
He's not that young. He's
25.
Are
we?
We
all know.
Oh, well, you know what I mean. I'm 35. But, I say you guys are young.
Yeah, you know? Yeah, but like Kyle Flanagan's been around long enough to have enough dominance to say, this is my job as a half.
Yep.
Part of my job as a half is to be part of the kicking game, to be part of the tactical kicking game, to be involved in that aspect
yeah,
of our play, and Kyle should be able to take some of that ownership, but he doesn't, either doesn't want it, or it's been directed not to have it. Like Ben Hunt seems to want to take every kick and does take every kick, and they're largely ineffective kicks with no imagination, no thought that goes into them.
Yeah, he's got
you look at Newcastle the other night. They had free kickers. They had Ponga, Cogger, and Hastings.
100%.
Well, we're actually stealing a bit of thunder from one of the questions that's coming up in a little while. But let's move now into, where is it, some moments of the match. And we'll kick it off, Coco, with you. Let's chat about the conditions first of all. Claude Lem, among others, thinks that the conditions were so bad that the game should have been called off and postponed until another day. Do you think the conditions were too dangerous for the players, or are you a rain, hail, or shine kind of guy?
I'd go no matter what, you know, and I don't think the broadcaster would want it to be cancelled. But I do understand how the weather, how crazy it was, because, like, I even looked at the game and that no one could catch a ball, no one could even try. It was like mud and water. I love those sort of games as well because it actually makes it more fun and theatrical, you know. But what day would you put it, you know? Like, when what day? Like a Monday night? Tuesday? Like, why would you cancel it? I remember one Anzac Day game. It was hailing. It was raining. It was windy. We had to stop it for, like, 10 minutes for it to stop lightning even. I still went. It was fun. I don't care if it rain, hails, or sun. I'll go to that football match no matter what.
No offence to Claude, but if we won the game, we wouldn't be having this conversation.
it was the same conditions for both teams, so that's
and Newcastle really kicked well, didn't they? And played
they
well.
Handled the conditions better than us. Same conditions for both sides.
But can everyone just realise, sorry, Jesse, but it was pissing down with bloody rain on that day. My backyard was a pool. By Saturday morning, my room was flooded.
It was all over the state.
Don't you realise that they get paid to do this? I'm not trying to yell. I'm so sorry, guys. I'm getting very passionate right now. But it was pissing down, and it was flooded up there. So I'm giving them a bit of a benefit. Yes, we fucking lost. Yes, we played like shit. And yes, but it's a team sport, and they should know better. But there were some good bits, some shit bits. But next week, they need to pull their fucking socks up and play a fucking game. Sorry, everyone. I'm so sorry if I'm swearing too much. Apologise.
That's good. At least Coco.
You've been a bit of a social butterfly lately and haven't been on the show too often, so you've obviously got a fair bit pent up, ready to explode. You're letting it all out tonight.
You're bursting bursting with
it. Yes, I do.
Get in there with the players for the game, Coco. Rev them up. That's maybe what they need.
I'll just show them Donnie's like lead up, and then I'll do the half time. So then I'm like, right, boys, this is what you got to do.
Talk to Flano.
Yeah. Flano,
you know.
Yeah, I don't think Claude was using the rain as an excuse for why we lost. And you know, I know Rob, you sort of had a bit of a tongue-in-cheek swipe at him, but he was more saying that he thought it was too dangerous for the players, and that playing in those conditions, if one little thing goes wrong, it could be a career ender. For me, I've always been, you play rain, hail, or shine, regardless of the conditions. The drainage on these fields is fantastic now, so they've got nothing to complain about compared to some of the players from yesteryear and the bogs that they used to play in. And me personally, I loved playing in the rain. I wish it pissed down rain every single week. I had absolutely no talent whatsoever. And when it rained, it brought everybody else a little bit closer to my level. And suddenly I was an okay player. I went from being terrible to mediocre. So I love playing in the rain myself. I think it's fantastic,
Donnie. Back in the day, you remember when they used to play in the mud? The Proven Summons one.
There it is. This one.
Yeah. Back in the day, they used to play in the mud. And you think back then, like players today, they don't realize that they don't play in things like that anymore. But they had mud all over them. They still play through it. And
yeah.
Yeah, I remember even when I got, when I was growing up, I saw games like that where players would play through the mud.
Wasn't there a state of the jerseys
would end up real muddy and dirty. And
wasn't there a state of origin?
Couldn't tell who was who.
No.
In the state of origin, when he kicked, tried to kick a drop out, it didn't even go anywhere because it was just you couldn't lift the ball.
Wasn't there a Bowline Canberra game in the snow?
Yeah. 100%.
Yep. Well, you couldn't see. The whole field was covered in white.
And the game Coco brought up was Anzac Day 2015. I remember that game very well.
Yeah, I think all of us remember that game. Where the first time I've ever seen a game paused in the middle of the contest to go off the field. It was obviously lightning around, and I guess that's fair enough. But they never used to cancel games or pause games for lightning in the past. But there was an AFL game just recently where they paused the game before the fourth quarter, and because of the lightning around, they wait for it to clear and they go back out there. So I think they play regardless of the conditions. I think the TV contract would not allow any other situation to occur. I think Coco brought that up, and it's a perfectly legitimate point as well, is that with the TV contract, they contractually have to play these games at these times. So,
Hazman, don't worry, mate. Peter Dowse will still knock off his 24 crownies every game. Rain, hail, or shine.
Well, a couple of years ago, you mentioned that, Donnie. I was at Wynn Stadium at an NRLW game as well. It was torrential rain. The girls couldn't see anything, but they still played right through it, and they were soaked. I've never seen rain like it at Wynn Stadium. It was dreadful rain.
Yeah, no, they still
played through it.
Again, there's 10 million examples. There was a game over here in Perth where the whole field was a swimming pool. There was I think it was South against the Warriors, and there was one try that Latrell Mitchell scored where it was a bomb that landed on the ball about a metre from the dead ball line, and it just stopped and floated, and he got there and dived and scored a try. Like, there's been way worse conditions than what we played in on Friday night that every fan can tell you about. There's a thousand examples. Anyway, Rob, pre-game changes always generate some debate. And for the second week in a row, Tom Eisenhuth was named on Tuesday to start at lock, but an hour before kickoff was dropped back to the bench. This time he was replaced by Blake Lawrie, who started at lock for the first time in his career. What did you make of the change?
Madness to me. Obviously, I don't want to bash up on Blocker. He's not playing as well of late. I think he'll come good with some more fitness. He had been injured. But I don't understand putting a player at lock who is not a lock. And then Eisenhuth has been playing really well for us. So I don't get it. I don't get that as a tactical. Is that tricking the opposition? Is that a massive tactical move that's going to give us a massive advantage in the game? I don't think so. I don't know. I think that was a silly one by Flano, to be honest with you. Especially changing a player who has been one of our better ones. And, you know, he had him on the bench, I think, hadn't he, Donnie Eisenhuth, previously, and then in the starting squad, and DeBellin as well too, and done a few things like that. But I don't know, this with Blake Lawrie at the moment, for me, it's just not, something's not right with him. So I don't know whether Flano was trying to get something out of Blake Lawrie by doing that as a switch to that position. I don't know, Donnie, but I don't know. I don't think it was a move that paid off for us, obviously.
He hasn't been playing well at prop. What the hell makes you think he's going to play that well at lock?
Well, exactly, Hazman. I mean, it's a specialist position, lock, that's for sure. And if you're not used to playing there, I don't get it. I don't get why he made that move, to be honest with you.
I actually don't think he played lock. I know it says that on the team sheet, but Jack DeBellin was in the team. Like, I think Blake Lawrie played prop and Jack DeBellin went to lock. Like, that's what happened out on the field. But on the team sheet, it said something different. So, I don't think it was that big of a deal. I just think Flano doesn't give two shits about what it says on the team list. Like, he'll put anything down, and he did it a couple of weeks ago. I think he had Ray Fatala Mariner was named on the team sheet at lock, and you could tell he was playing on an edge. He went out, he wasn't playing lock, he was playing on an edge from the first minute.
Yeah, old school type tactics, I suppose.
As Hazman said before, like, Lawrie couldn't hang on to the ball in dry conditions. What chance was he going to do hanging on in the wet conditions? So,
how does that happen, though? Like, go back and have a look at the stats from last season. He did not drop the ball once. He played every game for the whole season, didn't drop the ball once, had zero errors for the entire season. And I think he's had four errors in the last two games. Like, how does that happen? You go from never making an error, never. He was the safest player in the entire NRL, never made an error, never dropped the ball, and now all of a sudden he's become Josh Kerr. Like, how?
And very ill-disciplined, too.
Billy Burns was another one that, you know, I could have used him. That would have been a perfect example. I've missed an opportunity there.
Oh, you miss him, don't you, Donnie?
No, he can fuck off.
Nah, he's very ill-disciplined, too, though, to go with that, with these errors, and that's something his game needs to fix up as well. Some soft penalty gives away and just not good enough.
Yeah, Rory McDonald raises the point, raises a possible explanation. A few new players in, a bit of pressure on his position. Maybe he's not handling the pressure. Not sure. All right, well, here's a question without notice, and I'll just start at the top of my list, and I'll pick on Hazman because this one was supposed to be for Muzza. In the opening 3 to 4 minutes, you're going to love this question, actually. You pretty much already addressed it. In the opening 3 to 4 minutes, the Dragons' big man gave away two penalties for spending too long on the tackle player. First Blake Lawrie and then Frankie Marlo. It's not unusual for a referee to set the tone early, but did you feel that we were any slower than Newcastle?
No, I didn't think we were any slower than Newcastle. I think just Belinda Sharp saw it that way.
Yeah. No, I definitely felt early on that I thought the Blake Lawrie one was actually a little harsh. I know people love to bring up the fact that he gave away a penalty, but I thought it was an incredibly harsh penalty against him. The Frankie Molo one I thought was fair enough. But then the Knights would lay all over us and have a second effort and a bit of a push down. You're like, does your arm go that way as well, or is it only go against us? So there was certainly a couple in those first few minutes. I didn't think she was that bad, to be honest. I think she gave us a few later on. That evened it up, but definitely that those opening few minutes, I was very frustrated with some of the calls.
Well, she only penalised
you. Jesse. Yeah, well, that was probably both in that little 20-minute period where we hit the front. There was a couple of six agains as well, so there was a few in that little period where we got the better end of the deal. All right, Jesse, it was spoken about by several people in the group chat about how important the kicking game would be in these conditions. And Newcastle, they struck the first blow in this regard with a clever, unconventional little grubber between players that was perfect for the conditions. Talk about that first try if you like, but my question's more about the kicking game in general of both teams, that the Knights seem to kick to the conditions, whereas the Dragons seem to kick exactly the same way as they always do. They didn't change their kicking at all. Did you feel, in general, the kicking game played a big role in the result?
Oh, 100%. Newcastle had it clicked down to a T. They played the conditions very well, hands off to them. You've got to give it where credit's due. They just handled the conditions so well. Whether it was Callum Ponga, Jack Cogger, or Jackson Hastings, no matter who kicked, they knew what to do. Grubber kicks in the wet, very hard to handle, and they continue to do it time and time again. And it come up with the first try, which Jackson Hastings was quick to pounce on. And they saw that the Dragons were struggling to read those and hang on to those. And they continue to do it, and which they came up with a lot more joy, and they continue to do that throughout the game. And where we just, as you said, we just tried to do our normal kicks with the normal bomb, or not even trying to go for a 40-20. Sometimes Hunt does go for the occasional 40-20. Didn't even try that. Would have been perfect in these conditions. But yeah, he was just trying these bombs all night as he normally does, and Newcastle just handled the conditions way better than what we did. And that's just the perfect way to play wet weather football. Kick along the ground and make it difficult for your opponent to pick it up.
Yeah, no, I totally agree. I think they outkicked us, they outplayed us, they managed the game, they played the conditions really well, and a lot of people have said that. And for me, what that means, that comes down, a big part of playing the conditions well is the kicking game. Ben Hunt in the pre-game said kicking's going to be a really important part of this game, and then goes out and does exactly the same as what he always does, even in the second half when we're running into the breeze, still putting up the bombs, and they were coming back towards where he kicked them from. Like, there was no kick for distance. There was no thought of let's kick underneath the wind, kick lower and kick down into the corners, where Newcastle in the first half did exactly that. So it was terrible tactical kicking, but it's been terrible tactical kicking from Ben Hunt, from the Ben Hunt-led Dragons for quite some time now. Coco, as I sort of mentioned to Hazman a minute ago, that the Dragons had a nice little period after conceding the first points. We got a couple of penalties, a set restart, had a couple of line breaks, but it was Hunt for Lomax and then Lomax for Hunt that got us our point as we led 10-6 after 22 minutes. A bit of talk about the breeze we had at our backs in the first half. How big a lead did you feel we needed at that point, 22 minutes into the game, leading 10-6? That probably wasn't quite enough of a lead. How much of a lead did you think we needed to be comfortable at halftime? Nope, Coco's gone. No Coco.
Some idiot on the chat on Friday said that breeze is worth fucking 12 points.
Me.
No, it wasn't you. I don't think it was you.
Are you sure? I'm pretty sure it was Rob.
I'm pretty sure it was Rob.
Yes.
Because I had no commentary, so if you're trying to throw a barb at me, I had no commentary. I didn't even know there was a breeze.
There was 40, 60K an hour, I think it was, in the end, the wind.
Yeah. So you thought we needed as well?
Could have been Rob, but I just got this feeling like it was you, Donnie.
It definitely wasn't me. I didn't even know there was a breeze, mate. I was at the casino watching the game on, you know, one of the biggest screens in the Southern Hemisphere. But the AFL was the commentary that was on at the casino here in Perth, mate. I had no idea there was a breeze until Rob said there was one. Okay, looks like you're back. You just missed your question.
Oh, no, what was it? Damn it.
Well, Rob ended up having to answer it. He said we needed a 12-point lead. But
yeah, I would have said that. We needed a good start to the being in the conditions that were, at least we needed, 12, I would agree, at least 12 to 16 lead, and maybe even like a penalty, you know, when Jamie Sowell used to do those penalty shoot, like penalty goals, you know, that would have been good too, just because of the atrocious conditions. So I agree with Rob. We needed way more be in front. Yeah. So. Yeah.
Well, Hazman, and of course we didn't have a lead at halftime. It was only a few minutes later after we got to the 10-6 lead that Zach Lomax had a horrible defensive read. And all of a sudden, Newcastle were back in front. After this try, Ben Hunt gave Lomax and Jack Bird, to a lesser extent, an absolute serve for not staying out on his man. Do you see this as good leadership from Hunt in keeping high standards, or does this give further legs to the totally baseless rumour flying around social media that Hunt and Lomax don't get on?
Probably a little bit of both, to be honest. I mean, the captain giving a player reserve for fucking up, I mean, that's nothing unusual. Probably a little bit hypocritical from Hunt, given the way he bloody played. But, I mean, you'd be forgiven for thinking that there is a bit of truth, you know, to this, you know, it's sort of Hunt and Lomax don't like each other bullshit. You know, it could be a bit of truth to it based on that. But, yeah, a little bit hypocritical, I thought, based on the way that Hunt's, you know, been sort of kicking recently and, you know, how much he's sort of destabled the bloody team, you know, with all his I want out of here bullshit. So, no, I think it's time for Lomax to shut the fuck up and get on with it.
Well, fair enough. All right. Rob, the next couple of questions are kind of long-winded. I might just do this and see if this works first of all. I'm just going to add a bit of a video to the stage. The next couple of tries led to Sloan and Lomax swapping positions. So let's have a look at a few aspects of the first try. Now, as we roll this video forward, it's the last tackle, and there we can see where Tyrell Sloan is. Now, when we roll this forward, Sloan actually goes over to the blind side. Now, in this situation, why on earth would he go over to the blind side? Last tackle. Well, that's Kalen Ponga standing over on the blind side. He's attracted Sloan's attention over to that side of the field. But what happens after this is where the issue actually occurs for me with Tyrell Sloan. So he goes over to the blind side, but then he doesn't react quickly enough to come back to the open side and correct his mistake. So they come to the open. And if we freeze it there, that's where the ball strikes the boot. So this is the lead up to this try. We can see where Daniel Saifidi is. That's the try scorer right there. And there's Tyrell Sloan. Now, if Sloan shows urgency from this point, because Saifidi's got a straight run to the ball, maybe he's got slightly less distance to cover, but even with a little bit of a head start, you're probably going to back Sloan in a foot race against Daniel Saifidi. But he doesn't show any urgency at all. As we roll through and see this try, by the time he scores the try, Sloan isn't even in the shot. He's not in the camera at all. Ben Hunt shows some urgency trying to get down to the ball and misses it. Zach Lomax sprints back to try and get to the ball. Tyrell Sloan is nowhere to be seen. Rob, I suppose, based on this, do you think it's fair enough that Sloan got the axe from fullback for his lack of urgency in that situation?
Yeah, I mean, I think it wasn't only just that, Donny. Obviously, he was out of position. I mean, common sense tells you, yes, Ponga's on the other side, one player, but there was a lineup of players on the other side, right, the scrum. So common sense would say it's going to go that way. But, I mean, of course, it could have gone the other way. But, you know, if you're lining up all the other players, only one player on the other side, surely your winger's there and you know, someone else is breaking from the scrum. So Paul Reed, wrong position. And I think if you go to the press conference, I think Flano had a big point in saying that Sloan didn't put his body on the line. And you have to do that in every match. It was wet, yeah, shocking conditions, but he just didn't put his body on. And hence, even too, with his pace that he could have possibly got across and even slid and dived to try and get to that ball, but he was completely out of the picture, not even in the frame. So,
I'll stay with you, Rob, for the next question. Again, it was supposed to be Mothers. And it's another long-winded one, but it goes to kind of what you're saying about Sloan. So that first try there was the lack of urgency. Yes, he got caught out of position, but that's fine. If you show urgency to correct it, Sloan's got the speed to still get into the right position, and he didn't. He wasn't urgent enough to do that for me. So that was lack of urgency and poor positioning, as you've already said. The next was what Blano was talking about, that complete lack of commitment in defence on Dylan Lucas. Now, Raymond Fatala-Mariner was also horrendous in this play. He overchased, and he was the man that actually left Sloan isolated one-on-one with Lucas coming back. But Sloan looked like a petrified child in that one-on-one situation with Lucas. There was no desire to put his body in front of him, and instead he stepped to the side, made a feeble attempt at jersey grabbing. So with Tyrell Sloan in this game, we saw poor positioning, we saw a lack of urgency, lack of commitment, and a total unwillingness to put his body on the line. And we've seen Sloan fail miserably in wet conditions a few times now. Is it a case of him being just a terrible wet weather footballer and you just can't pick him if it's going to rain? Or is it deeper than that and he's not up to playing rugby league at a professional standard and we need to start thinking about moving on and finding a new fullback for our future? Where do you sit, Rob?
Well, I still believe he is good enough and has the ability to be in the top team in the NRL. I'm starting to think now it's the position he's playing at fullback, but I feel that he's better placed on the wing to get some more experience, learn his defence, learn his art, craft a little bit more with his defence. Maybe it's a bit more of a slide on the wing for him, not so up in front. Up and in tackle. I wouldn't be divorcing him completely, but I don't know. I see a young Addo Carr in Sloan, that sort of player, like a Peachy, and maybe he needs to be on the wing to get some more experience. In the wet weather, Lomax. I mean, look at Lomax. He caught a bomb on the dive, didn't he, Donny? He was sliding with his body, with his legs. You got to be able to have the balls to be able to do that.
He did catch that one, but there was another one where a Newcastle put a kick in. He slid. He was off his feet, completely out of position again. And luckily, they got to the ball before it went over the dead ball line, but it ended up that couldn't ground it. So Lomax certainly wasn't perfect positionally.
You're not perfect. I'm just saying, if you're talking about apple for apple, I don't know. I'm starting to feel with Tyrell, maybe with the fullback position, with putting his body on the line, especially like what Flannery's saying. I don't know. Maybe it's not the right time for him to be at fullback. Maybe he needs some time on the wing just to toughen up, to be able to get back to fullback again. I don't know. I wouldn't divorce him completely, but I don't know. If things keep on going the way they are, I don't know if he's going to get selected to fullback anymore, mate.
Well, Brady Stewart says, similar to Addo Carr, you're killing me with laughter. I'm a bit the same. Don't see any similarities to Josh Addo Carr. What is it that you see from Sloan apart from the fact that he's kind of quick?
Brady, I'm talking about him being a speedster, his pace, mate. That he's got. I'm not talking about the player. He's
the fastest man on the planet, according to Gus.
No, but I'm talking about his pace, Tyrell's pace. He's got exceptional pace. I mean, he's got to be in the top at least half a dozen players, probably in the comp, 0 to 100, 0 to 60, 0 to 70 or whatever. That's what I'm talking about. When Addo Carr was a younger guy, Addo Carr's always wanted to play fullback as well. Just his out-and-out pace, and that's what Slaney's got, out-and-out pace. I mean, Brady, did you watch some of the games? Did you watch some of Hunt's kicks when Sloan was playing on the wing? Hunt was trying to kick it out there for Sloan because, he's got the pace. So that's my only comparison with that. That's what I'm trying to say. I still think he should be in the team, but I don't know. But he's got to put his body on the line more. Yeah, 100%. I mean, I agree with the coach.
Yeah. All right. Well, before we move into some questions from fans, we might move into a little bit of a mini segment we've been running over the last couple of weeks. But one of the things we did at the start of the year is we got some of the Mad Dragons to go through their top 10 favourite players of all time. We had a look at Coco's one last week, and this week, he's not on tonight. He's usually on, but we'll have a look at Big T.
All the Mad Dragon Vodcast merch out there. There's cups, there's hats, there's T-shirts, there's everything. There's jumpers. Beautiful. Okay, before I get to my number one, I'd like to say it was a very tough task to pick my top 10 St. George Dragons, Illawarra player. I'll go through my number 10 was the ever reliable Brad McKay, great back rower. The hit him up and bash you, James Graham. Another, I've got to say, great player, great man. BMOS, the speedster. Number 8, Piggy Riddell. Number 7, funny man. He's on the radio now, does a bit of a TV appearance too, so shimmy, shimmy, whoosh. Great feet, great footwork, Mark Gasnier. Our ever reliable captain, Benny Hornby, took us to the 2010 grand final. Yeah, that was great. Nathan Blacklock was my number 4. Yeah, I would have liked to see a race between Nathan Blacklock, BMOS, and Tyrell Sloan. That'd be an interesting 100 metres. Number 3, the very polarising Chock Mundine. Number 2, English player, captain. Very, very good leader, Gareth Widdop. Now, drum roll please. My number 1 favourite St George Illawarra Dragons player is a vodcast friend, Jamie Soward. I arrived at the Dragon in 2007, after 2 years with the Roosters. Came halfway through the year and slotted straight into our 5/8 spot. Great player. Took over the kicking. Had a very distinct style kicking routine with a little march and then steps backwards and moves in and kicks the ball. Kicked the field goal in his first game against the Broncos to give us an 11-4 win. And that started off the cult hero, cult following of Jamie Soward. Scored his first try in round 14 that year and didn't look back from there. Played 141 games for the Dragons, 39 tries, 401 goals, 26 field goals, 984 points for the Dragons. Dragons leading point scorer. Many, many fond memories of Jamie. Jamie, quickest man over 40 metres apparently, according to Gus Gould. But I wouldn't doubt it and I wouldn't bet against it. So very, very quick man over the first 30 at least. Favourite moment from Sowie was that grand final moment. The game had been won. He had his arms out wide, stretched out wide. A big woo. Let's go. Come on. Fire up, Dragons fans. We've got to love Jamie Soward. Jamie Soward is my number 1 favourite St George Illawarra Dragons player. Thanks, guys.
And to commemorate Big T's number 1, Jamie Soward, we've got the shirt on Etsy to celebrate his favourite player of all time for the St George Illawarra Dragons. He thought it was too hard going back and doing all the St George players, but you can see that the quality of that one there, an absolute ripper, comes in quite a few different colours, so you can pick your favourite colours and get on the Etsy store. So just go to Etsy, search by store, find the Mad Dragons podcast on there, get around. Big T's number 1, Jamie Soward. I see a few in the comments saying that he was their favourite as well. Rob Bell saying he loves Soward. So jump on, get yourself a Big T's number 1 shirt, Rob. And Lisa Marie Cooper says one of her favourites as well. Still involved as the coach with the women's team. And Jess, I know he was quite high up there for you, but I think we've got your favourite on next week. All right, we might move in. Where did Coco go? So do we need her back because she's got the next question. So don't run away this time, Coco. Don't miss your question twice in a row. All right, we've got some questions from fans, viewer questions, and the first one is our weekly question about Dean Young. Roger Bastani says that we have conceded 130 points in 5 games, which at the time he wrote it was certainly the worst defence in the competition, and he thinks Flano's first changes should be to get rid of our defensive coach in Dean Young. Do you agree?
This was a very good question. Like, it got me thinking because I follow Matt Cooper on Instagram and he's been saying a lot like what this fella just said too. So I think, mate, I thought against Manly, our defence was great. That's what I thought. They defended the line and everything. I think maybe if Matt Cooper came into our club and he wants to, he's been wanting to come in, maybe Dean Young and Matt Cooper could work together and help the players. What does the fans think about that? because Matt Cooper has been saying a lot that he's been trying to contact the club to come in and help the players with their defence, their playing game. And I would love to see Matt Cooper come in and help the players. So I think, yeah, I think it would be great for someone to come, someone else with new eyes as well, and fresh eyes, fresh start, and go and be honest, you know, have that ability to go, right, this is what you didn't do right, fix it. It's not shameful. Just do your job properly, you know? So, yeah, I would love to see someone else do it, help the defence. So.
Yeah, I know that Matt Cooper, he keeps throwing his hand up and he's real big on social media. I just think that there is a little bit more to the story behind the scenes as to why Matt Cooper is not welcome at the Dragons. I know he blames it all on Peter Dowd. I have a feeling there's more to it than that. There might be a couple of people within the club that aren't as big a fans of Matt Cooper as we are. I know we loved him as a player, and but like he's one of the greatest defensive centres of all time. You've got to feel that he's got something of value to offer. And there has to be more to the story. There has to be some reason why he's saying, I want to come in and be the defensive coach for your centres, and we keep saying, we don't want you anywhere near the joint, mate. I don't know. I think there's more to that story. I don't know. I don't know what it is. I don't have any inside info, but you've got to think that if you've got a guy of that quality putting his hand up again and again and again, you'd get him in and at least give him a crack.
Yeah.
Like, you can't do any worse than the guys that are doing it at the moment.
Flano brought in Andrew Ettinghausen at the time at Cronulla. And, you know, pound for pound, you've got to say ET is like Cooper as a defensive centre. And it worked for Cronulla at the time, 2015-16, they won. So, I mean, there's evidence there, past history there, that can work, bringing in a past player of that ilk as well too. But I think you got to go look at it too. Did you see Flano's press conference? Did you see what he said in the press conference?
Yeah.
He's at an absolute loss. It's his job to get to the bottom of it. And he can't understand why we're falling away in games, why we're conceding as many points as we are. And he's almost saying there's a problem with the players. There's a problem with the players getting them to believe them, to believe it they can win. But there's a problem getting the players not to lose the way we've been losing as well too.
So, why is there a big gap between our best and our worst? When we're on. But when we're off, there's just a massive fine line between our best football and our worst football. It's been like that for a number of years, not just this year. Why is that the case?
Yeah, I'm not sure, but I do want to address the comment that's on the screen from Brian Barron, because the question was about Dean Young, not Shane Flanagan at this point. But, you know, he's saying that in terms of missed tackles, the actual defensive efficiency of the team is a hell of a lot better than it was last year. And in previous years, we've gone, we'll miss 50 tackles a game. We've only missed 120 tackles in the five games this year, whereas we were missing 50 tackles just about every single weekend. So that aspect of our defence, while we're still conceding a lot of points, defensively, in terms of making our tackles, we're doing that part of it. So that might be a bit of a plus for Dean Young.
How many times have the opposition teams, Jesse, you might know this, have scored within 5 metres or 10 metres of our goal line this season? Easy tries that have just gone over.
Oh,
it happened against North Queensland.
It'll be quite a lot.
Game. You know,
and
soft.
Is that just this year?
No, it'll be over a number of years.
Yeah. So,
but I'm saying
completely new coaching staff, like they, I don't know. I would also point out that the Cowboys last year, after round 12, with Dean Young as the defensive coach, had the worst defensive record in the entire NRL. After 12 rounds, this is not one or two games. This is after 12 rounds, they had the worst defensive record in the comp. Now they got better. they got better and they finished the year sort of, you know, mid-table in terms of their defensive stats. Maybe we've just been a little impatient. Maybe Dean Young is trying to change things. Maybe Dean Young is trying to do something different with our defence, and it's just going to take a little while, and we need to take a breath, stop blaming it all on one person, and trust in the process. Shane Flanagan is a quality guy, quality coach, and yeah, he's not going to be able to fix everything overnight. Dean Young's the same. He's not going to be able to fix everything overnight. And when we're trying to completely change everything with what we're doing, it's going to take a little while.
I would also say, go back
to last year with our wingers running in off the sideline and letting easy try after easy try. It still happens occasionally, but it's not happening anywhere near as often this year as it did last year.
How much of an input does Ryan Carr have in the team?
He's the attacking coach, so a fair bit.
Yeah, there's been a lot of talk about what Dean Young's doing, but the talk's been very quiet about Ryan Carr.
Again, I don't think too many people are all that concerned about her attack. I think her attack's been pretty good. So although the attack's going all right, Ryan Carr gets a bit of a free pass. So, the players really seem to like him, and we don't seem to have all that. I know we had that game where we got beat 38-0 and looked a bit devoid of ideas against the Dolphins, but apart from that, scoring points hasn't been a big issue. We've just been letting too many in, and I think that's the thing that people want to focus on. That the defence is awful, the attack's okay, but if your defence isn't right, you're going to finish down near the bottom of the ladder. So I think that's probably the biggest issue for a lot of fans. All right, Hazman, you're there, you're around, there he is. Bob Campbell has actually come to the defence of Tyrell Sloan. He points out, for those criticising his defence, that he actually made more tackles than any other fullback this round and is still the leading try scorer in the competition. Do you think the fan base has been a bit too harssh on Tyrell Sloan after a poor performance in the rain?
Possibly. We've all seen what he can do with it in attack. The issue that a lot of people have is with his defensive reads, as we saw a few minutes ago, with him being over on the blind side, and then by the time the try scored, he's nowhere near it. I'm not just talking about this year. Last year as well, he had some absolute bloody howls in defence. And honestly, I haven't seen that much improvement. There has been some improvement, but he's still a defensive liability for mine. I think that's what a lot of people are basically saying, is that, well, yes, we get what he can do in attack. It's what he can't do or doesn't seem to be able to do in defence that's the issue.
Yeah, no, like that's part of what I've kind of said about Tyrell Sloan a little bit over the last sort of 12 to 18 months, is that he's never going to be good in defence. Never. Never, ever, ever. You'll never be a good defensive fullback. But neither will Kalen Ponga. Neither will Reece Walsh. They are both always going to be awful in defence. They are no bloody good. They can't tackle. They're hopeless defensively. But what they bring in attack to their team allows their fans to forgive them for their flaws in defence. Now, Tyrell Sloan, he's good in attack, but he's not Reece Walsh good. He's not Kalen Ponga good. If he can build his attack up to be at that level, I think we'll stop talking about his defence. We won't give a shit about his defence. If he's setting up five tries and scoring two every week, then letting two in, it's like, okay. You just got to live with that. You've got to take that with the brilliance that comes on the other side of the ball. Whether Dragons fans can do that, whether Dragons fans are actually prepared to do that, or whether they just want to focus on the negatives of him and then they're never actually going to acknowledge that he's improved. I don't know. But I think it's a tough one with Sloan. He's at a bit of a crossroads now. He's off contract. The Dragons have been talking about extending him. But I think that after this game on the weekend, that might go a little bit quiet. He might need to put in a few good performances to have that chat come up again. Rob, James Gray. I love this question. This is a good one. This might...
JJG.
Yeah, we'll see how this goes. He asks, is Flanagan moving Lomax to fullback? Is it an attempt to get Lomax to stay? Despite the recent release, do you think there's any chance of a massive backflip from Lomax and he ends up signing an extension to stay at the Dragons?
No, because if you watch Flanagan's press conference, he's mildly pissed off with the Lomax situation. Sick of the questions, sick of the situation. He had fire in his eyes. I think Lomax has been one of our best players, if not our best player this season. And I think you could probably put him 5'8", you could probably put him centre, fullback, winger. He's on a purple patch. I think it was tactical by Flano. I think Sloan was having problems defensively on the night. When I say defensively, like what we saw with the try wrong position, not putting his body on the line enough. Like you said, maybe the conditions, I don't know. For me, James, I don't see it as – I wish it was. I don't want to lose Lomax.
Well, He doesn't like Jimmy anymore. He's grown up. He's James now.
James, sorry. So I don't see it, mate. Sadly, I think Flano is definitely pissed off with Lomax. I think we said here last week there's more to the story. There's probably stuff that's happened behind closed doors. And Flano did say, Jesse, the last couple of months – so I think there's been a lot of shit going down, and I think he's sold on by Lomax. I think we won't see him in the red and white, sadly, next season. So, and whether that's double standards with Ben Hunt and Ben Hunt stayed and all this sort of stuff, and whether Ben Hunt gets on with Lomax and all this sort of stuff, I don't know. But there's obviously other stuff that's happened that we'll never know about. So, again, sorry for long an answer, but I don't see it as, trying to save Lomax. I think Flanagan's fucking pissed off with him, and he's putting up with him because he's our best player at present.
Flano said, this Lomax getting his release has nothing to do with what Ben Hunt wanted last year. So I don't know why people think that's two and two together. They're two different players. They play different roles for the team, so I don't really get why they compare. I can see why people would say, oh, why did we fight so hard to keep Ben Hunt, but Flanagan didn't really put up a fight to keep Lomax at the club?
I think that's a very fair question. And a lot of people that I've asked that question to, they say, well, where are you going to find a halfback? Where are we going to find a halfback? There's no halfbacks out there, no quality halfbacks that exist. There's basically 35-year-old halfbacks and there's 18-year-old halfbacks and there's nothing in between apart from Nathan Cleary, who's spoken for. So that's part of the reason why he fought to keep Ben Hunt, is because there's not much else out there, whereas centres and wingers, dime a dozen. But is that a case of the Dragons making the same mistakes we've made in the past? We refused to pay Brett Morris what he was worth because Dragons management said he's only a winger. We still haven't replaced Brett Morris. We still haven't found anybody to come in and that do half of what Brett Morris did for us as a club. Let him go without a fight. So are we making the same mistake again, Jess?
I think we might be. We haven't had a quick winger since Brett Morris left the club. I mean, same happened with his twin brother, Josh, when Wayne Bennett came along. he saw him as a winger, so he let him go. I mean, back then he could have been a centre with him and Matt Cooper back then.
But also in saying that, Jesse, Brett Morris and Josh Morris could play fullback as well as wing and centre as well too. So Lomax is definitely a massive loss because of his ability to be able to play very well in all these different positions. So, you know, I mean, based on not calling him a utility, but based on a player that can play in this, why would you let go of one of your, or probably your best player? You know what I mean? I don't know. There's got to be more to the story as well too. But in what you said before, Donnie, how did Jackson Cogger end up at Newcastle then if there was no halfbacks available?
Yeah, well, again, he might have been a guy worth looking at, but
he wanted to go home.
Is he really that good? Like, I just think everyone looks good. Look at Brad Schneider right now playing for Penrith. All of a sudden, he looks like a good player, and he hasn't done it at any other stage. I think everyone who plays for Penrith is pretty good. John Karras says that Lomax is on 800K, and that's the issue. This one kind of annoys me a little bit. Like, first of all, he's not on 800K. So I've said that a few times. He's not. The media are just making up a number, and he's not on that much. But regardless, I think he's worth 800K. He's our best player. He's better than Ben Hunt. He's better than anybody else in our team. If he's not worth $800,000, who is?
If you're penning a team right now for next season, right, 2026, with Lomax being your top few players that you're penning number one, two, or three, or four, or whatever?
100%.
Yeah. 100%. So, it's just stupid, isn't it, really? Ludicrous.
Yeah, for me, he's 24. He's finally, like, he's had all this potential, all this talk, all this, you know, the gifted one that bloody Brad Fittler labelled him as when he was freaking 17 or 18, which is completely unfair. But it has taken him a while to get to the stage where he's finally starting to show that potential. But he's still got another 10 years of rugby league where he's going to continue to get better.
And he kicks goals.
The best is ahead of Zach Lomax, and we're letting him go without a fight.
And he kicks goals too. So, you know, he's a good bloody goal kicker.
Right now.
Hazman's mates in the comments now.
I thought it was Rob's mate.
Yeah.
Tell us about Steve Ali. He's just made a comment. It'd be crazy to let Lomax go. He's a natural talent.
You know, rubbing it in.
He wants him at the Dogs.
He's the guy who's going to meet Hazman behind the stand of Cogger, isn't he?
Look at that stare. Hazman's ready to go.
Hazman. Yeah. Come on, Hazman, unleash.
This is not the sledging pages, mate. Jets, this is another question that was supposed to be for Mother, but Daniel Ryan points out that Zach Lomax leaving seems to have had more of an impact on his best mate, Blake Lawrie, than it has on Zach himself. We've talked about this a little bit. With Laurie's poor form to start the year, do you think it'd be worth shopping him around to another club? And do you think there is any club that would want a player like Blake Lawrie?
I don't really think so. I mean, if he went to another club, he'd be a bench front-rower at best. I don't see another club picking him up. Yes, I know Zach Lomax says he's a good mate, and he's probably a bit upset that he's moving on at the end of the year. But yeah, I don't really see another club that would be interested in Blocker's services, and I think that's why he's committed to the Red V until the end of 2026. And I don't think I think that's the reason why he wants to stay here. And yeah, probably no interest from other clubs there. And you can see his form recently and over the years. He's just doesn't quite have the what you want from a front rower in the NRL.
Yeah, and that seems to be the consensus in the chat as well. And again, what does that say about out of the club? That the bloke that was our best player last year none of our own fans think that he would, there's any other club in the competition that would be interested in him because he's not up to NRL standard. But he was our best player last year. What does that say about where we're at?
Rory McDonald's hit it on the head. He's Trent Merrin 2.0.
I wish he was Trent Merrin 2.0. Trent Merrin was a great player. The game sort of passed him by a bit as he got a bit older, but Trent Merrin was a fantastic player. If Blake Lawrie had that sort of late footwork that Trent Merrin did, I think he'd be a hell of a lot more effective. Trent Merrin had an offload. Trent could ball play before or after contact. I don't think Blake Lawrie has any of that. He's a very one-dimensional player. He's a hard worker, and you know he loves the Dragons. He puts in 110%. I still think he's struggling with that rib issue at the moment, and he needs to take a couple of weeks to get that right. So go down to New South Wales Cup. I wouldn't be doing that with Blake Lawrie. I'd be saying get that rib 100% because at the moment you're not playing anywhere near where you were last year. He's nowhere near where he was last year, and I'm hoping that it's just down to the fact that he's still carrying that injury.
Hey, Steve Alley, if you want Lomax so much too, we'll trade you him for Crichton.
I'd rather keep Lomax just quietly, but anyway. Okay, so, all right, well, before we do get into some of the other questions that have come throughout the night, we've got a couple there that aren't really questions, but might spark a bit of discussion. I'll do my yearly, my weekly beer part of the show. I don't know, just a bit of fun. Today, what have I got today? I'm feeling a bit cranky with the way the Dragons have gone, so I thought I'd go some Thorny Devil. I think that just about thumbs up how I'm feeling, a bit spiky.
That's rugged, man. That's rugged.
Yeah, well, it just should be nice. I do like a New England IPA, but a passion for a New England IPA. So let's see how this one goes. Nice and jerky. That might grow on me. We'll see how we go. Got some nice bitterness to it. The IBUs will be up on that one, I reckon. All right, we've got a question earlier that came through from Brady Stewart, who I hope is still around for the viewer question part of the show. I'm not sure who we're up to. Probably you, Hazman. Sloan, Raveloa, Bird, Hunt, Lawrie, and the Molo brothers can all go. Do you agree with Brady? Do you think that these players we should all be trying to get rid of, even though they've currently got contracts? Do you agree with all of them, or some of them, or none of them?
So read the list out.
Tyrell Sloan, Mika Raveloa, Jack Bird, Ben Hunt, Blake Lawrie, and both the Molo brothers.
Jack Bird, yes, 100%. You'll fucking hate me for this, but Blake Lawrie, yes. Molos, keep Frank for a couple of years, piss off Michael. Raveloa, yeah. I'm a bit on the fence with Rava at the moment. He doesn't seem to be doing much sort of, you know, up the pointy end of the field, but that's not his fault. He's not getting any bloody ball from Sully. Look, the couple of the guys have got to go. And keep the rest. Blake Lawrie has, I reckon, I'm not convinced he's up to first grade standard.
What concerns me most about this list that Brady's put together is we have about 80% of our players off contract this year, and not many on his list are off contract this year. Most of them have multi-year deals still to run. Michael Molo's off contract. We've just re-signed Frankie, so that ain't happening. We're keeping Frankie. We've actually got an offer in front of Michael Molo for a one-year deal at the moment. He's expected to accept that. So Michael Molo is going to be sticking around. Blake Lawrie's here for another couple of years unless he requests a release. I don't think he's going anywhere. Ben Hunt, they're looking to extend him. Jack Bird has a mutual option that'll be decided around mid-year as to whether he takes that up or the Dragons take that up. I don't know whether the Dragons will, but Bird probably will on a lower contract. Ravaloa's around for another couple of years. Sloan's got another couple of years. Sloan's off contract this year, so that one, will certainly be worth discussing. But almost all our players are off contract, but all the players that Brady's put on his list aren't among them. So that's a little bit concerning that there's still some players with multi-year deals that some of the fans certainly think that we should be looking to get rid of. Who's next? We'll go to you, Rob. So John Muller wants to know if you think Flano will make the tough calls and drop players when it's warranted. We haven't really seen that from Flano yet. That's been basically bringing back blokes that are, you know, coming back from injury or dropping guys that are injured. Hasn't done a lot of actually dropping players just to bring in players from reserve grade that are going better. Do you think that he will make the tough calls when he has to?
I'd hope so, Donnie, because I'm a great believer in it being competitive for the team, for the squad. I think it's been lopsided. There's a lot of inconsistency in our games that we obviously won convincingly in the first round, and we got smashed in the second. Third round, scored some tries, but still on the scoreboard, you know, got smashed, and then had the win against Manly, but then that was riddled with errors, wasn't it, for both teams? Manly, obviously one of the worst games. Tommy Turbo, one of the worst games he's played in a long time, but win's a win. We still won. And then we were just not playing wet weather footy and poor against Newcastle, and obviously scoreboard tells you it was a thumping in the wet. So I think I would like Flannery to drop plays, but I think because we beat Manly last week and we lost, you know, the week before we beat Manly, I don't know whether he will. I'm like Hazman says, I'm sitting on the fence. I'm waiting to see him drop players, but I don't know whether it's going to happen in this game on the weekend. I think maybe he thinks he can still keep the bulk of the same team going, maybe dropping Blake Lawrie. And then I think Bird's injured. Is that right, Jesse? Bird's out.
Well, he's gone for scans today, so it's not revealed what the full extent of his injury is, but yeah, they said if there's any swelling there, it's most likely going to be a PCL injury. So I'd be surprised if Flano names him on Tuesday.
So it'll be a bit like what you said, Donnie, that he'll bring in players to cover players for injured players. It looks like he's changing the team, but he's not really dropping players for poor form. So is it Tupolotto probably come in on the wing, and we might see Lomax back at centre, and it'll look like, I guess, Flano's changing the team, but not really, mate, to be honest with you. Just doing what you said.
I certainly think dropping Blake Lawrie would be something that you wouldn't have thought would happen at the beginning of the season, a guy that just come off winning the Dragons medal. So that would send some sort of message. But, you know, again, if Harme Sele's fit, he's got to drop someone. Who's it going to be? You know, a guy that's had a couple of poor games in a row.
Ravaloa?
Yeah, well, again, I think if Bird is injured, I don't think – how does he drop Ravaloa? So he might be wanting to drop Ravaloa, but he's not going to bring in two new wingers.
No.
And if he brings in a second new winger, it's going to be Matt Finai, and you guys are going to love that.
No.
But you look at who's been in our 22. Who's been in our 22-man squad? It's been Tuipulotu and Matt Finai every week. It's not the only Finau. It's not Savelli Otamale. Those are the players that Dragons fans want to see. It hasn't been those guys that have been in our 22. It's been Matt Finai. So if he drops Ravaloa and Bird is injured, then it'll be Matt Finai on the wing and Christian Tuipulotu. It's not going to be the players that Dragons fans actually want it to be. Okay, so another question that came from El Habak, and I might go to you with this one, Jesse. And I don't necessarily want you to answer the question because we'll talk about that on Tuesday night about whether we think we're going to beat the West Tigers. But I might throw it over to you because we do have a bit of an announcement of a special guest on Tuesday night. So take it away.
Yes, that's right. We have a legend of the game, Fox League commentator, and be a Balmain legend, Illawarra Junior as well, you might remember. So Steve Blocker Roach will be joining the podcast on Tuesday. So that'll be on this Tuesday. He's our special guest for Behind Enemy Lines. We'll talk a little bit about his career as well, a little bit of a preview to the game next weekend against the Tigers at Campbelltown. But yeah, should be good having Lockie on the show, and yeah, it'd be great to chat to him about his career and also the game on the weekend. So yeah, be looking forward to having big Blocker on the show, Donnie.
Yeah, no, I'm definitely looking forward to having Blocker on. It will be pre-recorded, so I actually won't be involved in the chat with Blocker, but we're pre-recording the chat, and we'll have it on the show when we do the live stream on Tuesday night. Yeah, looking forward to seeing what he's got to say about his West Tigers and their chances on the weekend, but more importantly, having a bit of a chat about his career and how a guy from Illawarra ended up playing for the Balmain Tigers instead of the Dragons. At some point along the line, you would have thought he would have been identified by our scouts and brought into our squad, but it would have been. I think the Dragons fans would feel a little bit differently about Blocker if he had gone down that path, but looking forward to seeing what he's got to say. All right, well, we'll go into having a chat about our lower grades on the Mad Dragons podcast brought to you by Complete Warehouse Solutions. Sadly, our New South Wales Cup game against Newcastle wasn't live streamed, and so far there aren't any highlights from the game either, which is it's really annoying me. I keep going to the New South Wales Rugby League website and refreshing and hoping that the highlights are going to become available, but hasn't been on there so far. Those that were there said that the first try to Alec Tuatavake was a ripper. He also set up a try with a great offload, but ultimately it wasn't enough. We trailed 16-0 in this game, and then we scored two tries just before halftime and a third 1 minute after halftime to effectively make it three tries in 7 minutes to hit the front. We traded tries from that point, and the score was level at 24-all until Newcastle scored with just 4 minutes to go. But the Knights had a player sent to the sin bin in the final minute of the game, and we had a chance to snatch a late draw, but Newcastle held on to beat us 30-24. In the stats department, Dylan Egan led the way defensively, making 54 tackles in a tough performance in tough conditions from the young edge forward. But Ben Murdoch-Masilla was our only forward to crack 100 metres with 105 metres. And youngster Hamish Stewart is worth a mention. In his first cup game of the year, he played just 30 minutes, had 10 runs for 97 metres in that time. Now, the backs got through their work with Matt Finai, the most metres with 152, while Savelio Tamale had 9 tackle busts, but I am told most of Newcastle's tries were as a result of poor defensive reads from Tamale. Moving on to the Jersey flag games. Most of the Jersey flag games this weekend were actually postponed due to the weather, but ours went ahead up in Newcastle on Saturday. We were missing a couple of key forwards with Hamish Stewart, as I mentioned before, playing in the cup game, and prop Jet Liu was suspended after being sent off last week. Plus, we were playing a Knights team that just 3 weeks ago belted us 28 points to 4 at home. So I wasn't overly confident of getting a win, but I'm pleased to say that the young under-21s team did us proud. Kai Russell scored first, and then a first-half double to Kane Barnes saw us lead 22-4 at half-time. The Knights scored first in the second half to keep them in it, But Ben Rumble scored his second to all but wrap it up before Jack Quine crossed to seal a 30-16 win. And not a lot of lower grades action this week, Jess, with the junior rep having a weekend off, and that's due to potential wet weather, postponed games. So this week is just to play those games. I think there was only one in the Harold match we weren't involved in.
Catch up this weekend.
Yeah. So did you like? I guess when you look at the top six system, the top two teams both get the first week of finals off. So if you're running first and second, you get this weekend off and you get next weekend off, and then you're in a do-or-die prelim for a spot in the grand final. Do you see that as an advantage, or do you see that as something that might not actually be to the benefit of the teams that finish off the top?
It's sort of like the NRL. I mean, you win your qualifying finals, you go straight through to the grand final qualifier. I see it as a bit of an advantage. I mean, you're sitting back waiting for the other results, and then the other two teams the two or four teams have to go hard at it, and the teams waiting for the result, they're just licking their lips saying, oh, I hope they bash the shit out of each other, and then they're buggered by the time they play us. I mean, I can see the benefits for it, but for the teams that are playing, they get their fitness under their legs too, and match fitness into them. So I can see both sides to it, but for me, I'd rather have the week off and know you're fresh and ready to go.
Yeah, I think one week off is fine. I think when you have 2 weeks off and then you go straight into a do or die game, I don't know. It'll be interesting to see how that that plays out for the top teams in all the junior rep grades. Rob Bell saying the two props in New South Wales Cup, good players. Well, Billy Umby Fafita's actually been playing lock in New South Wales Cup, so I assume he's one of the guys that he's talking about. Tuatavake has been pretty good, but again, neither of them got over 100 metres. I mean, Tuatavake was 70-something metres, played 54 minutes and couldn't get over 100 metres. So that's a little bit concerning when you see Hamish Stewart getting 97 metres and then he played half an hour, so he played half the amount of time. So work rate probably not quite where you want it to be. And Viliami Fafita, he's now played, must be up close to 20 New South Wales Cup games for the Dragons now, and he has never once, not once in his entire career as a Dragon ever got over 100 metres. So that to me is concerning. I would love to, like, I think if Viliami Fafita's down in New South Wales Cup and running 150, 200 metres per game, then you go, this guy is batting down the door. He's got to be in the side. I don't know.
How close is Tuatavake with the NRL? I mean, I see him got named a couple of times in the 22. He must be surely close.
Yeah. Stephen Bates saying that Alec got thin-binned in the game. It wasn't on the New South Wales Cup site, and as I say, there hasn't been any highlights that I've seen of this game. But there was a sin bin for Jed Cartwright from Newcastle that was on the New South Wales Cup site. But I would trust Stephen Bates' information more than the New South Wales Cup site. So if he got a sin bin, I believe Batesy was telling me earlier that they scored a couple of tries during that time as well, the Knights, while he was off the field. It was a bit of a silly one to give away as well. So, he had that, and he said Billy was not good in this game. So he didn't have the best of performances in the wet. Maybe another bloke that's not a mud runner. I know a few people saw the game the week before against Manly where we won, and he had some really good strong charges. I would just like to see him do it a lot more often. If he does bend the line, but his work rate just isn't quite there at the moment.
You mentioned the Knights. So I just come across the Steelers. They're playing the Knights in an SG Ball semi-final this weekend. Is that an eliminator, or is that what's
an elimination game? So that's third versus sixth. So the Knights finished third, the Steelers finished sixth. That I think is the only junior rep game where the Dragons have a side. So the Dragons finished second, so they get the week off. The Tartagale finished first, so they get the week off. And the Lisa Fiola Cup Steelers, they finished second, so they get the week off. So the only aligned club is the Steelers SG ball side up against the Knights. Again, I'm not sure exactly how the system works, but I think the winner of that one might play against the Dragons in next weekend. So it might be Dragons versus Steelers for a spot in the grand final. I've also heard that it might be the highest ranked winner that plays the Dragons. So if the Knights win, they'll play the Dragons, but if the Steelers win, they'll play against the Roosters. And we could have a Steelers Dragons grand final. How
good would that be? That'd be well,
you can't lose, but also you don't know who to cheer for. That was the only game that was live streamed this year, and my sons were watching me watch that game. They're going, "Who are you actually going for? You're cheering for both teams." It's like each time somebody did anything good, I started cheering and celebrating what they were doing. And they're like, "You're going for both teams at the same time." It's like, I just want them all to do well. All right, so basically saying the second one was right. So it's the highest, the Dragons will play the highest ranked winner. So it's not a direct path.
So it's not like the NRL where you can say, "Oh, the Sharks will play the winner of that semi-final."
Yeah. So if the Knights win because they finished third, they'll be the highest ranked winner from this weekend, and the Dragons will play them. The Steelers will be gone. If the Steelers win, they're the lowest ranked winner. They will then go through and play against the Roosters, and the Dragons will play the winner of the other game. Bulldogs and Parramatta. It could be very interesting if we've got both our teams playing against each other in a grand final. But there's a bit to go under the bridge before then. There's only good teams left in this competition now. There's no easy wins. Some really good teams, really good players in both those under-19s teams, and certainly through the women's pathways as well. So looking forward to seeing how the Steelers go in both the Tartagale and Lisa Fiola Cup as well.
Leichhardt Oval on Saturday.
Yep. Looks good. In terms of the jersey flag, one guy that's generating a bit of buzz is Ben Rumble, the fullback. He missed the first couple of games of the season. I think he must have been out with an injury. But a few people starting to notice him now. He's got another double in this jersey flag game. I personally think he should be playing the New South Wales Cup. He's got to be a more likely option to play fullback than Matt Finoy in the NRL. I think he should be playing New South Wales Cup now rather than playing jersey flag. He seems to be too good for that competition, and I'd love to see him promoted. But it doesn't look like Flano sort of thinks that way with the young kids. We sort of had it the last hook where, you know, if you were good enough, you weren't playing SG ball. You were playing New South Wales Cup. Like, you would come up and you would play to develop you as a potential NRL player. Whereas Shane Flanagan seems much more of that old school where you play your age group first. Have you seen much of Ben Rumble yet, Jess, or still one that you're looking forward to seeing?
No, I haven't seen a lot of his highlights yet. So, yeah, I don't know too much about him.
Yeah, I don't know exactly what his stats are height-wise, but he's a tall, rangy fullback. He's a little bit different, I suppose, to some of the fullbacks that we've had in recent memory that are a bit slight and a bit small. He's a big guy. He's a great ball player as well. He's got a bit of a rocket pass that can. He's setting up tries. I think he's had something like 6 try assists and 8 tries. Don't quote me on those stats. I did see them somewhere, but I don't have them in front of me. So
you know what the club? Yeah,
looking forward to seeing how. Sorry.
Is Flanner looking at him down the future, or is there any progress that he could go to NRL one day?
Well, he did train with the NRL side during pre-season, which was good to see. That's always a pretty good indication if you're getting that opportunity to train with the NRL side. But yeah, I guess we'll wait and see as he develops through the season what opportunities he gets in the sort of more senior grades. All right, well, it's just me and you, Jess, now. Everyone's gone. We've got a couple more segments to get through. First of all, we move into news and rumours. And this question was supposed to be for Jesse, and luckily you're still here, Jess. Ben Hunt in talks for an extension after he was so desperate to get out of the Dragons last year and was basically forced to stay at gunpoint. What do you think might be the reason for this turnaround in attitude from Hunt and all of a sudden he wants to stay?
I think it's down to Flano. Flano's probably got a vision and Ben Hunt sees what he likes, what he sees in Flano's vision and what he has plans for the club in the next few years and how he can take this club forward and and get them back to where they need to be and be playing finals footy. And Ben Hunt, I think Flano sees Ben Hunt as a key part of that, and he has this plan to bring in these named players. And I know it's not going to happen overnight, but hopefully Flano can build that. And Hunt looks like he's at the forefront of that. And that's Flano sees that Ben Hunt is the player that we can build the team around. And I think Hunt is buying into Flano's vision. He didn't seem too keen on it before when Hook was sacked and there was unclear who was going to be the coach. But now that Flano's had that chat to him and really gone one-on-one and Flano's shared his vision with him, I think that Ben Hunt's come on board and, yeah, he looks like he might want to stay for 2026.
Well, before you ask the follow-up question, Rob Bell's just talking about a bloke playing on the wing for the Raiders tonight that was real fast. And I think Larry Flick is pointing out that that's James Schiller, who was in the Dragons system and we let him go. So we had this guy. He's originally from Young. He played for the Young Cherry Pickers. And he was in the Dragons system. The Dragons actually worked with him. They signed him. He was signed to a Dragons contract, but they left him in Young to play local footy so he didn't have to leave home, which meant that he didn't come down and play junior reps for the Dragons. He stayed in Young, played senior footy up there for the Cherry Pickers. Then he did come down. He played Jersey Fleet for the Dragons, and it was not too long after that that he got an opportunity at the Raiders and left the club. So he was a guy that was in the Dragons system. He was a guy that we recruited to the club and brought him in. But another one that we let go. So we're talking about we want that sort of speed in our team. We had it, and with quite a few, we've let that slip. Just a follow up on that last question about Ben Hunt. Jess, do you think it's a good idea to be extending Hunt for another year or two beyond 2025? He'll be, 37, 38 by the time that contract finishes? Do you think it's a good idea for the Dragons to be extending Hunt, or do you think we should be starting to look at other options?
It depends what's out there. I don't know what Flano's idea is. Like, are there any halfbacks out there? Are there any young... There's a drought of young halfbacks in our system to come through.
Well, I don't think there's a drought of young halfbacks. I think there's a flood of young halfbacks, if I'm honest. The problem in the halves scenario at the moment is that it's top and tail. You've got a flood of young blokes, these guys that are sort of 17, 18, 19, really good ball players. And then you've got, your Sean Johnsons, your Daly Cherry Evans, your Chad Townsends, your Ben Hunts, they're 35 plus, and there's nothing in the middle. Nothing in the middle. They're like, if you're going to rely, and a few people have said this, if you're going to rely on a young halfback, you kind of want an older mentor next to him. That's not Kyle Flanagan. You kind of want Ben Hunt to be there to guide them, but he's shown no ability to actually guide a young player. We've had a couple that he's tried to do that with, and it hasn't worked very well. So is Ben Hunt the right guy to be mentoring young players coming through? I don't know, it's a really difficult scenario in terms of what we do with halves.
But how do we go without Ben Hunt? I mean, are we a lot worse without him? Do we look to England? Like we mentioned earlier on the show, Cogger and Hastings, they had time in England, and look at them now. It's made them better. Do we look to England?
I think we have looked to England. I think we've looked at England and we've realised there's nothing there. I think we've had a look and, yeah, the players that are there that are any good have committed to staying there. They don't want to leave. They don't want to come to the NRL. The only one that wants to possibly come to the NRL is Jai Field, and he's not a half.
He's a fullback, yeah.
He's an okay fullback. He's a reserve grade quality fullback. So I don't think that there's anything. I don't follow the English game all that closely, but I really don't think there's anything there. I think there's tons of young talent. I think a guy like Ethan Sanders at Parramatta. There's a Kobe Black that plays in the. He's a young guy. He's about 17, 18. He's really young. He's a Brisbane halfback, a very talented young player. Jai Gray at the South Sydney playing in the lower grade. He's playing fullback, but again, he can play a bit of halves. He'd be worth looking at. Yeah.
He looks good.
Yeah, well, again, I don't think we're getting Galvin, but
you know, they've also got... He's 18.
But they've got Latu Fainu, they've got Jaden Sullivan, and they've got Jerome Luai coming next year.
And they've got Adam Dewey.
Yeah, well, he's another one that's been spoken about. I don't know. He's a bit more of a utility. But yeah, I mean, how old is Aiden Caesar?
Aiden Caesar's 31, 32, I think.
So, again, getting him in for a year or two because the Tigers aren't going to want him after this year, you wouldn't think. An experienced player, he seems to be doing okay for them.
Yeah, I wouldn't
it's
mind
a, it. It's another stopgap option, but we need to get a talented young bloke in, and I don't know who that's going to be. I don't know that he's in our system at the moment. Cade Reid looks like he's got a hell of a lot of talent, but as I've said before, he needs to fill out a bit. He looks like a stiff breeze would blow him over at the minute. And, if he can fill out, I think he's got a hell of a lot of talent. We've got Afton Ward and Nick Quinn who are doing pretty good things down in the Jersey Flag side as well. But it's a long way from Jersey Flag to the NRL, and I'm not sure they're quite what we're looking for. But who knows? There's a lot to play out.
I agree. We need a mentor if we're going to bring a young half in. You look at Cleary when he first came in the grade. He had James Maloney mentoring him. And then once Cleary was ready, James Maloney moved on. Jerome Luai come in. Cleary running the ship. Look at Cleary now. Best halfback in the game.
Yeah. All right. Well, the next question we've got in terms of news and rumours, the Dragons have apparently submitted their application for Vegas. Would you like to see the Dragons play what round one over in the States?
I haven't really thought about this one too much. I mean, seeing the games there this year, I mean, a lot of them were Australians. We didn't really get much to the American market, that is. I'm just a bit torn on it. It's a bit lot of money for the club to chip in and send 20-odd players over there. I'm not sure whether it's going to be beneficial for us. Only one team's come back from it really good. Some teams have recovered slowly from that return from the state. So, yeah, I mean, I wouldn't be opposed to it, but I wouldn't be all for it either. I'm sitting on the fence on this one.
You're going to have a sore backside tomorrow, mate, because you've sat on the fence all night. But every question we've asked you, you've got splinters. But that's okay. It's that kind of feeling at the club at the moment that we're not real sure what we want to do. We want to change everything, but nothing at the same time. me, it's all selfish for me. I think going to Vegas is detrimental to a team. I don't think it's a great way to prepare for your season. I think we've seen with South the damage that could do to a season. They had a lot of travel last year, and why the hell they put their hands up to go to Vegas this year, I have no idea.
Brisbane have started slow as well.
Yeah, again, they've had a few injuries. Whether that's all down to Vegas or not, I don't know. But I think that's just rugby league and can happen. It's a tough one to know how much of the issue is down to Vegas. But I don't think it's a good idea for the club, or any club, to be putting their hand up and wanting to go to Vegas. The NRL should be having to force clubs to do it rather than anybody putting in a nomination and saying, I want to go. I don't think any club should want to go. I don't think it's a good idea for a team that wants to actually contend for anything. And I think that next year's a big year for the Dragons. We've talked a lot about 2024 is already a write-off. 2025 is a year where we're going to see something different. And starting it in Vegas just puts us behind the eight ball to begin with. So I'd be a no for that. But also selfishly, I can't afford to go next year. If the Dragons are going to be playing in Vegas, I want to be there. maybe in 4 or 5 years' time, when I've got a bit more cash and a bit less kids eating up all my money. Again, selfishly, I don't want to go to Vegas this year. All right. Yep, we've got that one. Scott Fulton in talks to become Dragons head of recruitment. Would this be an upgrade on Shane Millard?
Yeah, I wouldn't mind Scott Fulton. He's got contacts in places. He did a good job when he was at Manly. Obviously, he got the Fanu brothers over to the Tigers. They're bright young prospects. Manly had a high opinion on him. But unfortunately, just what happened at the Tigers apparently was hired by the management, not by the coaching staff at the time with Tim Sheens and Benji Marshall. So, if we can get a guy that has some good contacts and brings the right players through to the club and brings some young prospects as well, I would be all for bringing Fulton to the club, and he's son of the legendary Bob Fulton as well.
Yeah, I think you get mixed reports on Scott Fulton and what he brings to a club, but everybody said he's got great contacts, and I think he could attract players to this club. I think he's a guy that can do that job. He's a bit of a slick operator that might drive a few people the wrong way, but I think he's a good option for the club and well worth having a look at what he can bring to us. And at the end of the day, recruitment is key.
It's not Millwood to Chris Holmes, it's Millard.
Yeah. Shane Millard is a different person to Ian Millwood.
Millwood's not involved in recruitment. He's involved in pathways.
Not related, but I do agree. Anyone's better than Millwood. I think Millwood's still involved in the club in some capacity. I've said it before. I think he is locked in a room playing with Legos and still drawing a salary. But they're trying to keep him away from everything.
While his old man's involved, he's going to be there.
Yeah, well, that's part of the dichotomy of the Dragons, isn't it? It's hard to get past. All right. Well, we've got one last video that I want to go through. It's a quick video unveiling the Dragons Anzac jersey for 2024. So I'll play the video, and then Jess, I'll get you to tell us your thoughts on the jersey.
Lest we forget.
I like the design. The bottom V with the poppies is very creative, and it's a nice jersey. I did like last year's one as well, but it's an upgrade on last year's, and I think it really looks good. And yeah, hopefully the boys can rediscover what the Anzac spirit means and show what how we normally perform on Anzac days, and really lift for the emotion of that special day, and play as a team and rise to the occasion, because I'm looking forward to being there this year. I haven't been to an Anzac Day game in years, and it's going to be good to see the guys live in action, and hopefully rise to the occasion and get the chocolates on that day, because as you know yourself, Donnie, this is probably the outside the grand final, this is probably the game of the season. It's a special game. Both teams, the crowd, 40,000 people at Allianz Stadium, it goes silent. And with the respect and everyone, we pay tribute to those who fought for us, fought for our country. We wouldn't be here today without those people. And I really like the look of the jersey, and can't wait to see the guys ripping in it in a couple of weeks.
Yeah, I've got to say, I absolutely love the jersey. I think it's better than what we've had in the last couple of years. And not to say that the last couple of years have been bad, but I really love this jersey. I think it's really well put together, and I'm looking forward to seeing the boys run out. As you said, Anzac Day is an incredibly special day for our club to be a part of that. And I hope that continues forever. Some traditions should remain in the game for as long as possible. And yeah, I'm looking forward to the game. I think the jersey's fantastic, and it's one I'll be looking to go into my pocket and shelve out for, because I think they've done a really good job with it. Just going back to the previous question, Stephen Bates wanting to know why Billy Millard's on the outer. I don't know the answer to that. Whether there's, he's only been in the job 5 minutes. I mean, is it a little bit harsh that we've got a guy that's only just started this season and we're already looking for his replacement? Shouldn't there be maybe some other guys that have been there a bit longer that you're looking to replace? Or is it a case of a guy the quality of Scott Fulton comes up?
I like Billy Millard. I know him. He's played for the club before. He's coached juniors in the club for many years. He knows the area well. Maybe he's trying to bring him in and help Millard Fulton. He's got a bit more experience. Maybe they can work together and try and get some players. I don't know if it's any indication that Millard wants it, that he wants Millard off. Maybe he's trying to look at Fulton to help Millard. Because I like Billy, and I reckon he'll do a great job in recruiting, and he might look at some young talent as well. But Flano has obviously had that relationship with Fulton at Manly previously, and that's probably why he rates him so highly.
Yeah, I guess at the end of the day, it's Flano's team, it's Flano's club for the next couple of years. We've got to give him full reign, full control, and full trust at the minute, and he's going to bring in the guys that he wants. I don't know how much he had to do with bringing Millard into the club, and I don't know whether they clash. I don't know. I don't have any information on that, but I'd certainly. I don't have anything against Billy Millard. I think he's, as you say, he's a great guy, and a guy that himself has built a lot of very positive relationships. And but we want to land the big fish. If he can land a big fish, then I don't think anybody's talking about Scott Fulton anymore. But if he can go out and get the players that we're looking for, then if he can do the job, then we'll keep him around. But we need players, we need talent, and that's the be all and end all. All right, into some forced and unforced changes. I think we've kind of spoken about all of this already, Jess, but we'll start with Jack Bird, left the field with that knee injury we've spoken about already. If he's out for a few weeks, what are the changes you make to the back line?
I'd potentially look at Lomax to move back to centre, but I might look at bringing Tuipulotu in as well. He's been in the squad for ever since round one. He's been knocking on the door for an NRL spot. I think his chance might be this weekend against the Tigers. As for talk, there's been Ravalawa potentially being left out. there could be another spot there. Whether Flano looks at bringing in, you mentioned Matt Fino, could he do a Smokey and look at a Sione Fino or Savelio Tamale? Who knows? It would please a lot of fans if either one of those two were looked at, give us a glimpse into our future. But as for Bird, yeah, I think maybe a Savelio Tamale to come into the centre, give him his NRL debut. And if Rava is copped the axe by Flano, I think Tuipulotu will make his Dragons debut.
I think if Bird isn't fit, Ravaloa keeps his spot. If Bird is fit, then Ravaloa might be dropped. But if Bird is unfit, then Bird goes out of the team. Ravaloa, who's just been dropped, comes straight back in. So I think what happens is if Bird is out of the team due to injury, Ravaloa moves from the wrong side of the field to the right side of the field and stands outside Lomax where he should have been all along. If Bird is fit, we should be doing this. Put Ravaloa on his correct side of the field and he will play better. Like, how many times do we have to keep making the same mistake as Dragons and getting the same results? You keep switching players to the wrong side of the field and they don't perform and you blame the players. It's your fault as a coach. Put them back on the correct side of the field. So I think that's what will happen. Bird will go out of the team. Ravaloa will go to the other side of the field, play outside Lomax. Tuipulotu will come into the team and play outside Sulley. That's what happens if Bird's out for me. That's what I would hope to see. My concern with that is then you've got Tuipulotu and Ravaloa on the wings, who are both basically the same person. Very similar style of players. They're both quite slow.
Wingers for the Tigers. They've got Charlie Staines and Junior Tupou.
They're both power wingers that can power over the top of people from close range, but they're not going to scare you from distance, and it doesn't fix our issue of lack of speed, does it?
No.
Yeah. All right. Well, the other potential change is Hame Saleh expected to be back next week. Again, we've kind of spoken about this. I know what your answer is going to be, but I'm going to ask anyway. Who makes way for Saleh to come into the 7-8?
I think Blake Lawrie. I think he needs just a 1 or 2 week spell in New South Wales Cup, try and find his form and confidence again until he gets his game up and gets a little bit fitter. I think Flano may give him a spell in reserve grade and get him some longer minutes and build his fitness and work on his game, and maybe in a couple of weeks he'll be back in the top grade. But yeah, I'd bring Hame straight into the run on side up against this pretty big Tigers pack.
Yep, and fair enough too. I mean, apart from those almost fourth changes, do we expect any other changes to happen? Any other players who should be worried Team List Tuesday?
Yeah, I might even look at a Toby Couchman. I think, I mean, how's he looking in reserve grade, Donny, Toby Couchman? He was 18th man against Newcastle, so he must be very close to cracking first grade. I'd even look at him as a on the bench for Mickey Molo.
Yeah, and I don't think that's a bad shout at all. I'd have Toby Couchman in my team. Again, if we're looking towards next year, then I'm looking towards next year. I'm looking towards the future. I know Tom Eisenhuth has done a reasonable job. I know Raymond Fatala-Mara certainly in round one was good, but the last few weeks I don't think he's been all that good. These guys are over 30. They're bit part players. They're fringe first graders. I'd be looking to get all of them out. I'd be looking to get Toby Couchman into the team. I'd be looking to get Alec Tuatavake into the team. I'd be looking to get Viliami Fafita into the team and Hame Saleh. I'd be making big changes to the structure of our bench. I think we need some impact at the moment. In terms of our middle third rotation, we have workers. We have Tom Eisenhuth's a worker. We have Jack DeBellin's a worker. We have Blake Lawrie's a worker. Frank Molo's got a little bit of impact, but he's the only guy in our front row rotation that actually has any sort of punch or impact. All the others are high minutes. They make their tackles. They do their job, but they don't bend the line. Either. Yeah. So I think we need...
Bono mentioned Selle is similar to De Bellin.
Yes. Oh, well, yeah, again, he's got better footwork. He's a bit younger. And, I think Selle's a different type of player to De Bellin. But, again, he's not a guy that's going to bend the line and scare the shit out of you. So we Fifita or Tua Tagovailoa or both of them need to be in the team. They need to be there because they're the size. They're the guys that can come on and have some punch. I'd be looking to bring him forward though.
Like you just said, he's got some good line speed, so that's what we do need to get our sets rolling.
I think Selle's probably somewhere between a De Bellin and a Blake Lawrie, but he's got faster legs than Lawrie. He's got better footwork at the line than Lawrie, and he probably has a bit more punch than a De Bellin. So, but maybe not quite the work rate of a Jack De Bellin, not quite the defensive technique that's going to, you know, bend the back and drive the ball under the ribs. And I think he's somewhere in between those two. But he's not going to change things significantly for us. We need different types of players to what we've had at the moment. So I'd be making some fairly significant changes to what we're doing at the moment with our forward pack. In terms of the backs, I don't know that we've got a lot of options. I've sort of said what I think the back line's going to look like. Sloan, Ravaloa, Lomax, Suli, Tuopolotu, Flanagan, Hunt. That's my back line. I don't think that's going to change too much because we don't have a lot of options. Sloan will be on notice, I guess, after a poor performance.
What about Marshy? Marshy was used in the back row the other night. What's the go there? Is he trying to...
I heard you say that. I thought he got... When Jack Bird went off, he went into the centres, and I thought he stayed in the centres for the rest of the back game. Row
after that. Okay, I didn't know. For period, so... Even the commentator said, what's Marshy doing in the back row? When we had lots of other back rowers there.
Again, maybe just wanting to get some speed in around the middle of the ruck on a wet night, a bit of footwork in close to the ruck, and Marshy might have been, you know, an extra ball player. They felt they needed another ball player. I don't know. I didn't actually notice it, to be honest, but and I didn't have commentary, so they didn't say anything. But I don't know. You got a utility player that I think the best utility players are the guys that can actually play in the back row. So maybe they're looking to get a little bit more versatility and a bit more minutes out of Jesse Marshy. And, you know, he can't just come on and play 10 minutes to give Jacob Little a rest. It's a wasted bench spot. So maybe they're looking to use him as a running forward if everything goes according to plan. Obviously, the other night it didn't, and he had to go into the centres, but... maybe just looking towards the future. Anyway, we might wrap it up there, Jess. Once again, I do like to thank everyone who has tuned in for tonight's show, and a massive thank you to our sponsor, Complete Warehouse Solutions. We've got a big show coming up next week on Tuesday night with Steve Blocker Roach joining us for Behind Enemy Lines. So that should be a lot of fun as we look to take on the Tigers. I'm sure we'll beat the Tigers next week, and then we'll be all talking about buying grand final tickets once again. Thanks for joining us, and see you next week. Come on, Dragons fans. Fire up.
Fire up. Red V's a part of me.
She wears it on her sleeve. As must tell tales of Dragons wins and June of victory. Tony and the MP crew will do their very best. Getting up top again on our breast with a red V on our chest. The Mad Dragon Podcast is a sheep of camaraderie. Navigating ranks down rabbit holes in the land of big red V. And so I peddle a sweet potatoes and food soup is our dream.